Folks, back again. So today we're talking about the Lovell, the first ship ever built on Bluebeard's Island, a ship that actually saw action during the War of the Second Coalition against Revolutionary France. So we'll talk a little bit about the Lovell and the Fraser shipyard from which it sprang. We'll talk about some of the context of what's going on in the world at the time of its construction, and a little bit about the French Revolution and some of these early wars. Finally, we'll get into the actual, the fate of the Lovell that it met in 1799 in somewhere in the Atlantic Ocean, where it was captured by four Dutch frigates. So what we can, and then from there, I guess we'll talk a little bit about kind of how everything all kind of wraps up and, you know, kind of close out at that point. So I'll begin by saying that my sources today are from the British Newspaper Archive, and also some encyclopedic sources just for context. And a little bit, I guess, also from Louise Manny's Ships of the Miramichi, and some sources from Memorial University in Newfoundland. So with that, we'll begin. Again, obviously, I'm not really an expert here, but I'm just somebody that's kind of interested in what's going on. If I've got my facts wrong or out of order or whatever the case may be, I trust you'll let me know, because I want to learn, and that's how I'm going to learn. And like I say, if you've got questions or if you've got ideas for future episodes, do please leave them below. So we begin in 1788, so about 9 years before the building of the Lovell, James Fraser gains part of Bowbear's Island. So James Fraser had come here in 1785, come and set up an operation, kind of an export operation, along with James Tom. And been very close with William Davidson, and when Davidson died, Fraser was an executor on his estate. He gains access to Bowbear's Island 2 years before Davidson's death in 1788, but he only gains 5 acres. So it's a very small plot of land. He's really using it as a base of operations for a fishing enterprise downriver. So he petitions the government to try to get an expansion, to see, can we get a greater portion of land. Now, his reasoning behind this is basically that the springs on the island, of which we know there were several, or at least there were several wells, all fed, I guess, by the one spring. So that access to those is on Crown land. So the 5 acres that he has, he can't get access to fresh water. He has to go into Crown land anyway. Why doesn't he get an expansion for that? And in order to kind of provide his workers with a little bit more space and so on and so forth. And also to expand his operations. So he does get this. Now he gets the island in small parcels. Eventually owns the whole thing by 1805, which is a little bit outside of our time period. But what does happen is that James Fraser decides that probably in the early part of the 1790s, he's going to move from being primarily a fishing operation toward lumber and timber, I guess more specifically. So unfinished logs rather than cut lumber. So What prompts this is the fact that, you know, even though fishing is good here on the Miramichi River, it's still facing a lot of competition, both locally, regionally, provincially, and internationally, of course. So he sees in timber a bigger resource and a bigger chance of money. Because, of course, like I say, the weight of a log and that same amount of fish, you're probably going to get more out of the log at this time, especially with the situation that's brewing overseas. And we'll get into that in a minute. So the situation is he needs different ships. Obviously, the ships that he has for transporting fish are good for transporting fish, but are not maybe as good at transporting timber. So he begins a shipyard on Beaubear's Island, and his master builder is Charles Vye. Now, Charles Vye, he was building ships in Dorset in England and came to Miramichi by way of Newfoundland. Now, he did spend some time there in Trinity, I believe, and eventually comes to the Miramichi. He sets himself up as a shipbuilder under Fraser and Tom, but also has a couple of enterprises at Wilson's Point as well. So, in 1797, he builds the first ship that we know of that was totally constructed on Beaubear's Island. So I think there was a little bit of confusion on this matter in the past. I know the Friends of Beaubear's Island in our interpretation and in our tours, we talk a lot about the Miramichi, the first ship completely built on the Miramichi by William Davidson in 1772. Now, I think the issue arises out of the fact that I think for some years we did talk about this ship actually being built on Beaubear's Island. This is probably best acknowledged by the fact that we've got a plaque in the back room of the Interpretive Center that has the Miramichi on it, along with other ships that were built at that time. So, I mean, that's, again, it was certainly built near Beaubear's Island. It may have included components from Beaubear's Island. But as best we understand it now, based on the evidence available, that the Miramichi was probably built closer to where William Davidson lived, further upriver, rather than at Beaubear's Island. So, but again, and there may have been ships that were built on the island before this time, but we do know that in 1797, for sure, the Lovell is constructed. Now, the Lovell weighs only about 200 tons. It's not a big ship, and certainly not as big as some of the ships that would be built on Beaubear's Island in the years and the decades to come. But it's sold, and it's sold to Dan Pennell in Topsham over in the UK, and eventually moves back to Newfoundland. And we're going to leave the story there for a minute while we talk about what's going on in the world, because this is really what's driving James Fraser to kind of move into the timber business. So, as an impact of the American Revolution, which had caused William Davidson some problems years before, France is in real trouble. Now, I'm not going to get into all of the background. There are books upon books about the French Revolution, and there are courses upon courses, and I've taken a few of them, about its impact throughout history. Now, I think that the American Revolution certainly has its place in history, and that place is probably unassailable from a certain point of view. That being said, I mean, the French Revolution is much more influential, largely because, I mean, it impacts most of Europe at the time. And its model is kind of used over and over and over again throughout history as a model for revolution, whereas the Revolutionary War and the American Revolution is certainly referenced, and is certainly that example is also used from time to time. But again, we definitely see a bigger kind of radiating impact, not least because, I mean, it touches off about 25 years of war in Europe. Whereas the American Revolution certainly, no doubt, probably leads to the War of 1812 shortly thereafter. But really, the American Revolution ends, and the American Republic's first major trading partner becomes Great Britain. So, I mean, economics sort of overlay everything. Whereas the French Revolution, like I say, leads to about 25 years of conflict, leads to really, in a lot of ways, is a century of Franco-German conflict, which is only really resolved of in the back half of the 20th century, really. So, I mean, a century probably and more of turmoil there between France and the German states, later Germany. So, again, all of this very important, but again, all of this kind of outside the scope of what we're talking about today with the Lovell. Just to provide some context. So, in 1789, with the country in a lot of turmoil and with a need for reform being seen and kind of being identified at the time, and a real kind of cash crunch, and the government sort of, well, the government really does, this kind of break from the king, form a general assembly apart from the king, and begins to kind of govern in its own right. The king, Louis XVI, tries, is kind of made a constitutional monarch, doesn't want to live kind of in that space, wants to kind of be an absolutist, like his predecessors, runs away, is captured, is tried, is killed, and his wife with him. And this touches off a period of, again, the Madame Guillotine, and touches off a period of terror and other things that will continue for some time until eventually the Directory, and then on and on and on it goes. The Consulate, the Empire, so on and so forth. All of that being said, like I say, basically touches off a period of great instability, first in France, but then also in Europe. So, the execution of Louis XVI and Marie Antoinette, that causes a lot of problems in other countries. Because, of course, I mean, there's a lot of other monarchs out there. Now, of course, on one hand, a lot of these other monarchs do not want to see what happened to Louis XVI happen to them. They don't want this revolution to spread. And, which... In some ways it does. In some ways it's brought in at the point of a bayonet. In other cases it does kind of spread organically, and not for the first time that we will see in European history. But at the same time, Marie Antoinette is the Holy Roman Emperor, the King of Austria, the King of Hungary. All three of those guys, one person. That's her brother. So, I mean, you know, there's a family, there's a lot of jokes made about the interrelationships between European and dynasties at this time and throughout history. But yeah, I mean, it really is. That's his sister that you've just killed. So, you know, that's probably something that the Holy Roman Emperor probably took personally. You know what I mean? That's it. So, the War of the First Coalition touches off. By 1793, Great Britain becomes part of the First Coalition. It begins to fight against revolutionary France. And so, by 1797, the Treaty of Campo Formio is signed that puts an end to that war between France and all of the coalition combatants except for Great Britain. Great Britain remains at war with France. Now, it's not alone for very long. Great Britain becomes kind of the perennial coalition partner. I believe it is involved in all seven coalitions. Spoilers, the Second Coalition War is not going to go very well for the coalition either. Nor the Third, the Fourth, the Fifth. The Sixth works out really well, and so does the Seventh. But it takes a while to get there. This is it. So Britain remains at war, but it doesn't remain alone at war with France for very long. And because by 1798, intrigues in Malta and then also in Egypt and in Switzerland bring in other coalition partners, and the War of the Second Coalition starts. Now, this is a war that sees the rise of a certain military officer who will later become a certain general, who will later become a certain emperor, Napoleon Bonaparte, who attacks Malta and then also attacks Egypt in this particular conflict. So into this sails the Lovell.